Please, don't make the same mistakes that I have. Welcome to the Tarantula Collective. My name is Richard, and if you enjoy videos like this or pretty much anything about tarantulas, scorpions, or other invertebrates, make sure you're subscribed and hit that notification bell to turn on all notifications so you're alerted every time I upload new content. A couple of years ago, I uploaded a video. It was a top 10 mistakes keeping tarantulas, and it is by far the most popular video on my channel. But I wasn't able to cover all the mistakes that I've made as a tarantula and invert keeper, so I thought I would do a follow-up video, and we'll count down another 10 mistakes that I've made and I've seen a lot of other people in the hobby make as well. So whether you've just got your first tarantula or you've been keeping for years, keep watching and hopefully you're not making the same mistakes that I've made. So the number 10 mistake a lot of us make in the hobby is not being patient. Whether you're waiting for a dealer to ship your package, you're waiting on your tarantula to eat or maybe come out of its burrow, especially waiting on spiderlings to molt, this hobby, if it teaches you nothing else, will teach you some patience. There is no rhyme or reason or calendar or countdown as to when your tarantula will molt or how fast it will grow or how much time it will stay hidden in its burrow. And sometimes the worst thing you can do is dig them out of their burrow or bother them while they're molting because it's just gonna stress them out and may even result in things taking even longer to develop. And tarantula and invert dealers are shipping hundreds of different species to hundreds of different customers all over the country. And depending on weather and shipping delays, sometimes it can take weeks after you place an order before you actually receive them at your house. So you gotta be patient, you gotta learn to wait. And when it comes to taking care of your tarantulas, sometimes you just gotta leave them alone. They're gonna stay in that burrow as long as they need to. They'll seal up the front and you don't wanna disturb them. Your tarantula may go weeks or even months without eating. In most cases, that's completely normal. You just drop some food in. If they don't eat it within a few hours or maybe a day at most, pull that food out and wait a week or two before trying to feed them again. Trying to feed your tarantula every single day until it eats could cause it to stress out and go on hunger strike even longer. So be patient, give your tarantula some space, and don't bother them unless you really need to. Now, this next mistake is one that I've made myself and I've seen a lot of people online make it as well, and it almost always ends tragically. And that is not protecting your tarantula from cats or other pets in your house. Now, most of us that keep tarantulas and other inverts keep other types of pets as well. Most households have at least a dog or a cat, and sometimes mixing the two of them can create some problems. Now, I've got a dog that's just clumsy. It's got a long tail that's wagging and sometimes will just knock things off the table or will bump into a shelf or just create havoc stumbling around the house. Cats, on the other hand, are a little more insidious. They'll jump up on a table or shelf and intentionally push something off, especially if they see something like a tarantula moving around inside. Of course, there's also issues if you have something like a snake that you let just kind of slither around your room. They could inadvertently knock some enclosures off a shelf or table. So as a tarantula keeper, you always need to make sure that your enclosures are secure on the shelf or table that they're on. Because it can be devastating to walk into the room your tarantulas are kept and see an enclosure that's been knocked on the ground, busted open, substrate is everywhere, and you have no idea where your tarantula is. So do what you can to keep your dogs and cats away from your enclosures and make sure that they're secure on whatever shelf or table that they're on and avoid making this common mistake. Now, this next mistake is one that I've made probably way too often, and that is not labeling your tarantula enclosure immediately. Now, whether you just brought a new tarantula home or you're rehousing a tarantula that you've had for a while, it is very important to label that enclosure as soon as possible. Now, sometimes when you get a new tarantula in the mail, you can pull the label off the vial it was shipped in and put it on the enclosure. But some dealers just write the species name with permanent marker on the vial. So you'll need to write or print your own label. And many times I've been rehousing a tarantula and go to pull the label off their old enclosure and put it on the new one and it rips, or I'll pull it off and it's just not sticky anymore. And instead of printing or writing a label right away, I'll say I'll do it later. And that turns into tomorrow or the next day. And before I know it, weeks or months have gone by and now I have no idea what species is actually in that enclosure. And the more tarantulas you have in your collection, the more difficult and frustrating this can be, especially if it's a spiderling, because it could take months or even years for that sling to start showing the adult coloration or patterns that will help you to easily identify what species it is. So no matter how much of a hurry you're in, Always take a few seconds to print out that label or handwrite a label and stick it on that enclosure before you walk away. Now, this is a mistake that I would venture to guess we've all made at least once, and that's not remembering to shut the lid or lock the door on the enclosure. For the most part, tarantulas don't move around a whole lot, and they'll stay in or around their burrow. But every now and then, they like to go for a stroll and test their boundaries, and may even push up on a lid or on the door just to kind of see if it opens. And if you forget to put the lid on the enclosure or shut the door completely and latch it shut, there is a chance that that tarantula may be able to get it open and will just walk right out of its enclosure. And if that happens and you're not there watching it to see it happen, that tarantula can disappear rather quickly. So you always want to make sure that anytime you're feeding, watering, or rehousing your tarantulas, that you've got that lid on tightly, that you've shut the doors to that enclosure. If it has a latch or any kind of locking mechanism, that you make sure that that is locked up tight. And this also implies to spiderlings or small juveniles, you want to make sure that the air holes, the ventilation in that enclosure is not too large. A spiderling can escape through a ventilation hole the size of its carapace. It can squeeze right through there. So always make sure the ventilation holes of the enclosure is small enough to keep the spiderling from being able to escape. And something I like to do at least once during the day, especially towards the evening, is to come down and just give a quick check to all my enclosures. I walk around and try the doors, push down on the lids, just visually survey all of my enclosures and make sure none of them are open or could be opened very easily. It just takes a few seconds, or in my case, maybe a few minutes, but it doesn't take long at all, and it will help you sleep a lot better at night. Now, this is a mistake you usually only make once, especially if you're new to keeping tarantulas, and that is letting the substrate in a spiderling enclosure dry out. Now, it really doesn't matter the species of tarantula. Nearly all spiderlings do require a little higher level of moisture than their juvenile or adult counterparts. This is even more imperative to species that are more moisture dependent, like chilibrachys or Asian fossorials in general. You need to check on your spiderlings 2 to 3 times a week and drop a little bit of water on their substrate to kind of keep the moisture level a little higher, because spiderlings lack the waxy coating on the outside that holds in the moisture or the humidity, so they're very vulnerable to dehydration. This is a mistake I've unfortunately made myself, and I've seen hundreds of other people make from time to time, and it can be devastating to see a little spiderling curl up and die, especially if it was a very expensive species. So keep an eye on the moisture level of this substrate and don't let your spiderling enclosures dry out. Now, number 5 is a mistake that I have embarrassingly made one too many times. And if you haven't made this mistake yet, please heed my warning, you'll thank me later. And that mistake is not taking urticating hair seriously. Now, you'll see a lot on message boards and on Facebook and other social media, people saying that urticating hairs aren't that bad. But that really depends on the type of urticating hair, what species of tarantula it's coming from, how sensitive you are to those hairs, and how many times you've been exposed to them. Now, urticating hairs are a type of setae on the abdomen and sometimes the pedipalps of a tarantula. They can kick them off into the air, they can transfer them directly onto your skin, and they even kick them off onto the substrate or the webbing in their enclosures. It's a defense mechanism, but those hairs have barbs on the end of them and sometimes even all the way up the shaft, and when they lodge into your skin, they stay stuck, creating a histamine reaction that can cause itching, rashes, even burning sensations, and welts. And those effects can be even worse if they were to get into your eyes, nose, or mouth. It could cause difficulty breathing, temporary blindness, and all kinds of other problems. And I've tried every home remedy I've come across online to try to alleviate the itching from these hairs, and essentially nothing works. Especially when you're dealing with Theraphosa, Acanthoscuria, and Nandu species of tarantula. But everyone's different. Everyone has different reactions to the hair. But despite what a lot of people may think, there is no building up a resistance or a tolerance to urticating hair. The more you're exposed to these hairs, the more severe the reaction to them will be. So protect yourself, be careful, and try not to get haired. Now, number 4 is a mistake you typically only make once. But unfortunately, I've seen a lot of people make this mistake, and that is not having an emergency plan in place for your exotic pets. Now, whether it's getting evicted or having to move suddenly, breaking up, getting a divorce, just getting kicked out of your house, or an impending natural disaster, like forest fires, flooding, earthquakes, hurricanes, you name it. You need to have an emergency plan in place so you know what you will do with your tarantulas, scorpions, snakes, whatever exotic pets you have in the case that you have to move them quickly. Now, I have an entire video on this topic, so if you want to dive dive deeper on this subject, I'll link that video right up here and you can watch it once this video is over. But the important thing is to have a plan in place. It's better to have a plan and not need it than to need a plan and not have it. Now, this mistake is one a lot of us are guilty of. And if you just got in that hobby and only have one or two tarantulas right now, this is a mistake that you're definitely eligible to make soon. And that is buying too many tarantulas too quickly. Now, I've made more than a few videos on this topic, but I think it's still something that needs mentioned. Because it's very easy once you get into this hobby to quickly grow your collection from one or two tarantulas to 10 or 20 tarantulas to over 100 tarantulas. Especially if you're ordering your tarantulas online, because it costs just as much to ship one as it does 20. So it's very easy to justify buying multiple species at once. In fact, sometimes it's a really good idea because you're gonna save a lot on shipping. I think a lot of people don't look ahead and they have a bunch of spiderlings that are small and they're in small enclosures that all fit on one shelf. But as they molt and grow and get larger, they're gonna need larger enclosures and it's gonna take up a lot more room in your home. And it's very easy to get overwhelmed and not have enough space for all the enclosures or not have enough time or even money to continue feeding them and take care of them the way they should be. Giving your tarantulas and other inverts the best care possible should always be more important than growing your collection. So pace yourself, take your time, and don't grow your collection too quickly. Be responsible. Now, this mistake is one that's been being made since probably the hobby started. And a lot of times we don't want to learn from other people's experience. We want to try it out on our own. Unfortunately, most of the time, it's with devastating effect. And that is trying to keep tarantulas communally. Now, there are a few species of tarantulas that people have successfully kept communally for a very long time. For example, the Monocentrophus balfouri or the Socotra Island blue baboon. In fact, I keep those communally. I have an enclosure right over here and it's thriving. But you see this time and time again the longer you're in the hobby. People trying to keep species communally that just don't do well in that type of setup. Like Avicularia avicularia. Right now a lot of people are trying to keep Neotheli insi or Postlotheria metallica or other species of Postlotheria communally with varying levels of success. And of course there are some species that just can't be kept communally at all, like a lot of Gramistola, Brachypelma, Pamphibida species. You will have no luck keeping an orange baboon tarantula in an enclosure with another OBT. But despite all of the warnings and advice, some people still insist on trying it. Then they're devastated when they realize the enclosure that once had five tarantulas now only has one extremely large and fat tarantula. So heed the advice and experience of other keepers and don't keep tarantulas communally that have no business sharing an enclosure. I mean, it's just being cruel to the tarantulas and it's gonna end up costing you a lot of money. Now, this last mistake is one I see people make way too often, and I've been guilty of it myself, so don't think I'm judging you or anything like that. I mean, I'm sharing my experience here. These are mistakes that I've made and I've seen other people make. So the number one mistake I see people making is not researching your tarantula's care and husbandry before buying it. Now, trust me, I am very well aware of the temptation to impulse buy tarantulas or other exotic pets. Whether you're shopping online late at night or you're at an expo and you see this beautiful tarantula or scorpion or snake right in front of you at a good price, you don't want to miss this deal, so you buy it right away. But doing this can have devastating effects. You really want to at least take a few moments and Google that species. Last thing you want to do is bring home a species that has really potent venom or is extremely fast or has very intricate husbandry needs. Essentially getting something you're not comfortable with or prepared to take care of. Last thing you want to do is spend a lot of money on a very cool new pet only to have it die a few weeks later because you didn't give it the proper care. This hobby is supposed to be fun and relaxing. You don't want to end up taking care of something that's causing you stress and frustration. Yes, a lot of Postlotheria tarantulas are beautiful. They're gorgeous species to have. But if you're not comfortable feeding, watering, and rehousing a species that can be very fast, defensive, and has some medically significant venom, then you probably shouldn't add that to your collection until you're comfortable enough and feel prepared, so you can give it the best possible life that it deserves. Now, hopefully you found this list helpful, and if you haven't made these mistakes, you can learn from my experience and avoid making them yourself. And if there are some mistakes that you've made that didn't make this list, be sure to tell us about it down below in the comments. Let's share our experience and knowledge and help each other out. Let's get a real good conversation going on down there. Now, if you're new to keeping tarantulas or considering getting one in the near future, I've put together an entire playlist of videos just for you that you can check out right here. And if you'd like to catch up on all my past top 10 videos, just check out this playlist right here. As always, I appreciate you watching. Subscribe if you want to see more. Thanks for buying Tarantula Collective merchandise, and I will see you next Tuesday.